Welcome back. So now we're going to start talking about the different types of categories of sensors and transducers so you can understand the different ways that we can go about transforming physical information into actually digital information. So the first classification I'm going to talk to you about is actually the largest category, the resistive sensors. In addition, this is the most common used for a lot of displacement types of measurements. But let's go ahead and dive in. We'll talk about it. Let me get this on here. There we go. So one of the most basic types of resistive sensors that have been around for decades and decades are potentiometers. It is an active sensor in the fact that you have to either apply a voltage across it and measure the current, or apply a current across it and measure the voltage to see the change in resistance, because that's how that works. So we can measure things like displacement, and it doesn't matter, usually like knobs, if you think about things that rotate in your car or something like that, those can be potentiometers because we can tell how far we've rotated, or translational of things that slide. And these are typically resistive elements once we have an excitation and we move the needle, so to speak, we get a different value of resistance that tells us where we are. And so it's pretty quick. It's usually kind of a zeroth order. So it's as fast as we can turn it. In other words, we usually can't turn it faster than it can respond, so we don't even notice any variations on it. Another type is strain gauges. This is also an active sensor, and this is when we're trying to measure displacement changes. So let's say things that are stretching or that are compressing or that are moving in some ways. So that's what strain is. It's a fraction of change of movement in a direction. And we can look at it in one, two, or even three axes if we wish, for different strain gauges. Oftentimes they're bonded to whatever it is that we want to measure that change of distance. And then there's also unbonded, where it's just attached at ends. So let's take a look at some of these types of ideas. So here's a potentiometer, a typical dial that you would see on lots of different electronic systems, where again, you get a different value based upon where it's turned, and then you know what you're looking at. Some of them actually have set points to where maybe it's got, you know, four settings or three settings or whatever it is. And so for each one of those settings, as you measure it, that means something, right? So maybe it means off, on, and automatic, or something like that. So let's say like for your lights in your car, or it could be a whole manners of things. For a linear displacement, this could be figuring out, like on our manufacturing line, where something is, or where a printhead is, because we want to control that printhead and we need to know exactly where it's positioned in space. We can measure that through something like this. And so these are different types of designs. Typically, you have an input voltage here. And so this is the equation if you have an input voltage on a very basic system, where you apply a voltage, that's the VI, and then you have a change in the resistance, that's what RX is, and then you actually measure the V out. And so the output voltage is a relative ratio of the changes of resistance going on inside, so you can tell where you are. So we use that voltage out and then use the math to figure out where we're actually at. Same thing with strain gauges. So now strain gauges here, it's based on certain types of resistance that we can measure as things change. So for example, here we see like a bar that gets stretched. So it has an original distance L, little L, and then say we pull on both sides with a force. Well, it's going to change a slight amount, and it could be like a fraction of a centimeter, but if it's a strain that we can measure because the resistance changes, different materials will show a resistance that will differ because we've stretched it by that little delta L. So and resistance is a property of different types of materials. So it's based upon the resistivity of the material, rho, times the initial L, and times some type of cross-sectional area. And so this is a general model for lots of different types of materials. And so when you get things like that are strain gauges, you want things that have a relative good sensitivity, where you get a big change in resistance for small changes of L. Unless you're trying to figure out larger changes, then maybe you get something that's not as sensitive so you can detect larger stretches or compressions. It's also related to what we call a gauge factor of that material, which is really just the change of resistance over the initial resting resistance, which is over the change of L, dimensional change, divided by the initial L. And then strain gauge sensitivity then is that measurement of voltage, the change of the output voltage, because remember, we usually have to apply a voltage in or current in, and so we measure that output voltage for the change of L. So that's really when we're turning it into electronics, and on the back end, when we're trying to turn it into data from an analog standpoint, what is that voltage change? So maybe for every millimeter of change, that would be delta L, maybe we get a millivolt out. So we get 1 millivolt per millimeter of change in L. And in that way, we can tell how much strain we have fairly directly. Now, different materials have different properties. And this is probably a very old list. There's actually lots of other types, but these are some of the consistent types that we have, at least in the medical world. And so you see some different things like Constantine, isoelastrics, germanium and silicon types, which are great because you see a lot of those now, even in smaller levels that we can use with our circuits. So you see more and more types of materials like that. And if you notice, they have different gauge factors. So the ones with larger numbers give you a little bit more output per input. And it also tells you if there's a relationship between temperature sensitivities. So sometimes temperature itself, because temperature has an effect on dimension, right? So if a lot of materials, if they get hotter, they expand. And when they get colder, they contract. That's going to affect this measure. And so it gives you kind of some sense of how to do that. But how do we overcome some of these things? Because we're talking about sensitivities of where something that's changing based on other factors, not just the ones we're trying to measure. And there's different ways to kind of approach this. There's the strain gauges that are attached to the ends. But one way we can do this is what we call a Wheatstone bridge. And the reason for this is we can have several different strain gauges, and we can have them in different directions too. We'll look at that. But then we can average out the change of the moving elements versus the non-moving elements, and then we can look at that. So what the great thing about a Wheatstone bridge is it allows us to apply a voltage across one area. So on this diagram, it shows an input voltage putting across points C and D. So we apply that voltage there, but we measure across points A and B. And there's a relationship in the equations for that. I'm not so interested in this class that you understand all the electronics equations. That's not the focus of the class, but the application of it is important, and what the output is important to know that you're getting a change of voltage out versus the voltage that's coming in. Now, there's different types of strain gauges for different things. So this is a type of strain gauge where you actually bond it, basically like you glue it or epoxy it onto the surface that you're trying to measure. So as that surface is measuring, this system is measuring as well. And if you notice, for them to get more sensitivity, they actually make the pathway go back and forth and back and forth. So that, let's say the original member is only changing a millimeter. Well, if I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 pathways, and that's where the gauge length is, I'm getting 10 times that change. By making something that goes back and forth like this. So it's a way to amplify that signal. Now, what oftentimes is done then with these bonding types of strain gauges is you can make bridges. You can make quarter bridges, half bridges, full bridges. Myself, I like full bridges the most, even though they're most expensive. The reason is because you can put then strain gauges on off axes so that you can subtract out noise. So you can subtract out things like temperature. You can subtract out things like changes in another direction that's not on the axis that you're interested in. And then if you notice, they show two different examples. They show ones where we're having a member where we're pulling on an axis axially, and then there's also a bending one. So if you're trying to measure a bend on something, like a beam or something like that. So in essence, the more strain gauges you get. And on the bridge, this is actually part of that Wheatstone bridge. Instead of just having a fixed resistor in one of those spots, let me go back. So if you notice, like, we have R1, R2, R3, R4. Instead of having a fixed resistance, you actually can make them strain gauges themselves. So all of these are adjusting in different directions. So a quarter bridge is where you'll have one strain gauge across a Wheatstone bridge. And so that's why I call it a quarter. And generally, these are general numbers. There's still variation depending upon material types and things. You may get a sensitivity of 1,000 microstrain gives you about a half a millivolt out. And that's per input volt. So again, let's break it down. So you have a sensitivity at 1,000 microstrain, which is very small. You'll get about a half a millivolt out per volt that you put in. Say, okay, well, that's not that great. Now, it has a very low sensitivity, but it is good in one direction, but it has a lot of other issues with dealing with noise and other things. It doesn't compensate for temperature changes. It doesn't reject off-axis issues. So it also is subject to all those things changing as well. So that's why in general, it's usually not quite recommended. A half bridge modifies that a little bit. You get a little bit more sensitivity because now it's about 1 millivolt out per volt in. So you're getting about 10% efficiency there. It does have some temperature compensation and it rejects offset axis strain. So this is actually kind of a happy medium on cost. Or you can go full bridge, and this is where you have high sensitivity. You do reject all off-axis strain, meaning anything in other directions. So if I only want to measure in the X direction, but I have things happening in the Y and in the Z direction, and I want those rejected, a full bridge will do that for me. And then I also have compensation for temperature and if there's any lead resistance. And here I'm getting 2 millivolts out per volt in. So I'm getting about 20% efficiency. The difference is the cost, right? It's about four times the cost of a quarter, twice as cost as a half. So those are that's kind of the balance in decision making that is played. And so this is kind of showing if you have different resistors. So this is like in a quarter bridge application. So ZX is where we have our strain gauge. Z1, Z2, Z3, they could be other strain gauges or off-axis strain gauges, but let's assume they're constant for now. And this kind of shows how the equation works out. So remember, we're measuring VBC, which is the output voltage across point B and point C. It's going to be equal to VBD, which is the voltage of point B to point D across Z1, minus VCD, which is the voltage from point C to point D across Z2. And that equals our Vout. So here's the derivations for the equations. Again, I'm not concerned with you understanding all the electronics equations as to how this works, just understanding what it essentially outputs. So we have equations for VBD and VCD. That's using traditional circuit diagram analysis. And then we get ZX, which is where our strain is related to, right? Is actually really a function of the other three impedances. These are actually resistances. We're just using impedance here instead of resistance. So Z3 times Z1 divided by Z2. And that's what ZX is actually equal to. Then we have the relationship. Now ZX, again, it's like RX. So the change in RX, we're going to get so much out versus so much of a change in the resistance. And that's where our sensitivity comes out too. And so that's what a quarter bridge example would look like. So that's a little bit down in the weeds. So let's kind of backtrack a little bit and look at applications for these things. So we can look at strain to measure pressure. So we can have a diaphragm, something that changes with pressure. And then we have strain gauges either connecting the diagram or adhered to the diaphragm. So as we have pressure increasing, we get an increased stretch of our strain gauge. And so our displacement goes up, we can measure that. There's other types of strain gauge sensors in accelerometers to where you can measure three different axes and figure out what's happening in these types of things. Oftentimes they will have strain gauges on little weights. And so these little weights are typically designed as kind of cantilever beams. So they'll wait, and then they'll, as you accelerate, they'll flex, and then they'll come back as you're not accelerating anymore. And so you can do that in one direction. You could do it in another direction. So now you have two axes, and you do it in, trying to figure out the right direction, the other direction. So you can have all three of those happening at the same time and figure out acceleration in three dimensions, so that now you can tell, for example, if your phone is going up, going down, rotating, and all those types of things. You can figure that out from an accelerometer. And this is kind of showing an example of that, where you might have a mass and some dampening fluid and a cantilever beam, and the strain gauges meet into that. And this is actually a very common sensor in lots of things these days. So accelerometer seems to be where a lot of development is at. AEDs, so automated external defibrillators, they use accelerometers to measure the depth of CPR chest compressions, so that they know if you're doing the compressions deep enough or not. Eye watches for runners include foot pods sometimes that contain accelerometers. Your iPhones have accelerometers. Your phone phones have accelerometers. They're everywhere. You can measure strike force in training. So you tell if you're getting in a crash, if you're driving, if you fell. All those things are great applications for accelerometers, which are all related to strain gauges. So that's enough for the resistance types. The next talk I'm going to get into are the inductive types. Thank you.